regular features, a regular features, a regular features, a regular features show.
Welcome to Regular Features, the feature show that's the same for every feature we do.
Every time, always.
My name's Joe Scrabbles, and I'm joined by Steve Hogarty.
Hi.
He's wearing a fetching shirt.
Thank you.
Gav, who's not wearing trousers.
Hiya.
That's a spoiler for later on in the episode.
We always spoil what happens later in the episode by telling everyone like what our features are.
Yeah, we're trailing.
Oh, that's true. Let's trail. Yeah, when does trailing become spoiler?
Teasing.
Tease. Yeah, tickle.
Official teaser. Gav, what you got for us this week?
Ooh, politics.
Yeah.
It's all around us, but I've managed to put it into a big orb, the shape of a feature.
Nice. Politics orb.
Even though it's orb-shaped.
God.
Steve, what
some of these politicians, I'd like to stick them in an orb.
Ho, ho! Save it, baby.
Christ.
Save it for Westminster.
I've been to the dentist, and I've discovered a horrifying truth about my dentist.
I, unfortunately, was gonna do one feature which turned out to be socially unacceptable, so I replaced it with B facts.
Yes.
B knowledge. B
scheme
stuff coming at you.
Yeah.
But that's not till much later, because before that, it's this.
Milk me, and then just hold me, because my name is Juicy Susan.
Do you guys follow the King Billy on Facebook?
I probably don't, which seems bad.
That is bad. You should. Although, to be fair, all Locke does at the moment is post up pictures of really beautiful looking pizzas, and I'm trying to be really healthy, and the pizzas look amazing. But I just love, like, he puts a lot of himself into the Facebook updates. This one starts. This is about doing local deliveries. He says, "I've got the plastic screen man coming in a bit, so I'll have to be quick today." Yeah. He's going through all the beers that they've got. He said, "There's Green Devil, the first delivery we've had from Oakham since, waves one arm towards the beginning of the year." It's properly on form, and if you don't drink it, we will.
It's really good. Yeah, follow on Instagram. And it's nice to see Log writing in a sort of a, not professional, but like way more professional than his regular features output.
I do love that the way more professional has led to this in the 25th of June, which was, "By Jove, this weather's enough to wilt a chap's dander."
Oh, that's excellent.
Which on regular features is, "It's cold and my dick shrank."
This is great as well. If you go to thekingbilly.co.uk, because it's a pub, they have to legally have a age thing. And it says, "The King Billy and Secret Pizza. Hello, we're a pub. Are you 18? And then it says in smaller writing, "I wish I looked young enough for people to ask me. Now look me in the eye. Are you 18? Yes, no. That's excellent, that is.
Very good.
Very nice.
You don't realise sometimes, like, you think, oh, like, he should be writing for GameStop. You just go, no, it's still being used. Like, he's made that landing page better than any other pub's landing page.
Yeah.
That's excellent, that is. And that's real talent. Real talent.
He's always on.
That's the thing, you can't switch it off.
I can't stop reading.
When you learn how to play pool properly.
Some of these are great. Not much beer left this week, but I'd rather find it a good local home than have to chuck it all into the canal.
Oh, that is excellent. So good. These people don't know. I hope these people know what they're getting.
He does this. Like, I didn't realise he did this almost every day.
Yeah.
Quiet day excellent. Yesterday, stern fatherly face. Drinking beer isn't just for the sunshine, you know.
this is great. So good.
Oh, I'm very glad I followed the King Billy Pub on Facebook.
And on Instagram.
I don't think I follow on Instagram, actually. I'm going to get straight on that. That is good. That sounds like an advert.
Yeah.
We have been paid zero for that.
No.
If anything, we're paying him.
Yeah, that's true.
Mugs.
we're getting screwed. That's it. He's off the podcast.
That crafty log.
Hello. I used to come around here looking for features.
I haven't seen you in a while.
Because I had my fill of features, but I've run out. Do I have any regular features?
Well, just listen to this.
Thank you.
And now it's time for Steve's regular feature. Steve's been to the dentist. Hello, my name is Steve. I've got teeth. Did you know that? I've got a beautiful set of teeth. Uppers, lowers, and round the back, if you know what I mean.
Round the back.
Talking about molars.
That's what chocolate's made.
I think it's an indictment of my ability to get my shit together. I'm having braces for the third time in my life because I don't like wearing retainers. So I've been to the dentist. And I had a curious experience at the dentist because after about 15 minutes with him, it became apparent that he did not know what teeth are. So I started taking some notes.
Right.
These are the five times my dentist clearly didn't know what teeth were.
Holy shit, this is an expose.
Mm.
It's like Watchdog.
I love it.
Cowboy dentist.
One. When he asked me to open wide. The first time I suspected that my dentist didn't know what teeth were was seconds after asking me to open wide. When he looked inside my mouth, he let out a small but audible gasp, paused what he was doing, and took his phone out to look something up.
Shit.
Two, when he touched one of my teeth with his dentist pick. When my dentist was finished on his phone, he said, "Well, all right, I suppose," and resumed examining my mouth. The instant he touched one of my teeth, however, he recoiled in fright, turned to his assistant and said, "It's hard," then took out his phone again and Googled, "Tooth hard, why?" Three, when he pointed to a map of Britain and said, "This is your average tooth." I should have guessed that my dentist wasn't totally clear on what a tooth is when he pointed to a map of Great Britain and said, "This here is your average tooth, much like you'd find in any supermarket, really." Then he circled Norfolk and said, "This is enamel where the gums live." Time number four, when he asked if I flossed and if I could please tell him what a tooth is. The main clue that my dentist doesn't know what teeth are came when he asked me how often I flossed and if I could please describe the shape and color of a tooth to him. After I told him what a tooth looks like, he said, "Congratulations on passing the test. I had to make sure you knew what teeth were before I could let you anywhere near one." And finally, this was the nail in the coffin, really.
Oh, shit.
When I asked him if he knows what teeth are, I became certain that my dentist doesn't know what teeth are when I finally confronted him about it and he became very defensive. "Of course I know what teeth are," he said. "I know how they crawl inside your mouth when you are a baby. I know how they dissolve if you leave them out in the rain. I know that you have approximately 100 of them. I know that they can chew through branches and wood, but not metal. I know that they are the shape and color that you said earlier, and that dogs have one big tooth, and that's how barking works. Now I'm bored of talking about teeth. Please leave me alone." And then, just as I walked out, I overheard him say, "Siri, what is a tooth?" And that was my experience with the dentist.
It sounds frightening. Why?
Doesn't it fill me with confidence.
It looks like he's hit them out. Because, like, I'm looking at your mouth right now.
Ah.
And where there were plenty of teeth.
Mm. Yeah.
Now it feels like there's really not enough.
He's taken some away.
Did he think braces was give you one tooth like a dog so you can bark?
Yeah.
That must have been it.
Try it.
He did extract a lot of what he said were things from my mouth, and he put them in a little velvet pouch and said, "I'd better send these off."
"You won't be hurting Steve anymore."
"Whatever you are." Yeah, so I'm sure I'll be getting those put back in as soon as he finds out what he's done.
As soon as the wizard lab sees the bag.
I was just watching an episode of Hannibal, the TV show Hannibal, yesterday, because I stopped watching it, and I don't know why. But I went back and now I'm really into it. So it's going to be a lot of Hannibal content.
Yay.
Nice.
On this episode of the podcast. No. to be fair, that used to happen all the time in the early days of regular features. It'd be like, what are you into right now? Whatever script I've written this week. So,
oh, yeah.
But
that's why every now and then I keep making Mad Men jokes.
Yeah. I noticed that very prominently last week.
So Clara's watched it all. So Clara was working yesterday while I was watching thing, and she was just like, "Are you shouting things because you think it? I think it's funny because I don't. I'm not listening to you half the time. I've got earphones on." I was like, "No, I'm shouting stuff for me." But it was a bit. It was a bit where a man is killing people. But right at the beginning, it looks like it might be an animal that's killing people. Mm. And what's happened is a man has built a bone suit of lots of different animals.
You forget that occasionally Hannibal's just an episode of The X-Files.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing, though, because 80% of it happens in fucking Will Graham's mind. Mm. When something nuts happened, I was like, oh, shit, maybe mad stuff is real in Hannibal Land. But there's a bit where I think they basically purposely shoot it. So you're like, oh shit, because it's a little bit of a cold opening like the X-Files. Mm. But it looks like there's like a monster running around eating shit. but I just shouted, bullshit.
Imagine being your poor neighbors. Fucking hell.
But that's the thing. Well, imagine being my poor girlfriend who was just like, she took her earphones. I was like, what did you say? I was just saying that I thought it was bullshit.
Imagine if she thought you were talking about her art.
Yeah.
Bullshit.
Do it again. But she was just like, are you shouting for me? I was like, no, I'm shouting for me, baby.
She's gone now.
And that is my story about Hannibal's teeth. Sucking on my peaches like you wanted me. Calling me all the time. I'm grinding sugar on my prissy peaches behind all other time.
Regular features. Regular features. Regular features.
Oh! Guys. In the last episode of Regular Features, I said, well, against my will, it was settled on that I was meant to do a politics feature.
Politics, yeah. Question mark.
But what I did instead was I wrote in a tweet and I tweeted it out. and I know that's not necessarily what I should have done or what is expected of me.
You tweeted about politics.
Yeah, I did.
Tweet about, so no politics. One would even have known it was a feature.
I know. Well, I mean,
it's just the same as everyone else.
I think that's the it's all well and good listening to a feature about politics and going, I could do that. It's very different. It's very different when you jump out of the passenger seat into the driver's seat and then you're like, oh shit, I don't even know where I am. What's a car? and that's what's happened here, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Because I've used up all of my politics into a tweet.
Right.
But I'm not gonna, is not, it? I'm not gonna, no, I'm not gonna, I'm not, I'm not, I feel bad about it. I'm not gonna disgrace you all by reading it out and just bringing attention to how good my tweet is.
Right.
That's mm-hmm. That's up for people on Twitter to make up.
So you're gonna do who can fart first?
I stink right now, so no. No, but this segue is nice. I do think at the moment, maybe there is a little bit too much politics.
Mm. Uh-oh.
Interesting.
I think there's not enough politics.
Sounds like we've got a centrist on our hands, Steve.
Just call me centrist Steve, and I think what the world needs now is more politics.
Yeah, but for me, this came to my attention today when I saw a tweet came into my timeline. And I that's the thing. I've increasingly started unfollowing, muting, and blocking people because I can't be asked.
I like how you say a tweet came into my timeline like you're a PI and the tweet's looking for you to solve a crime.
You just saw that's this tweet behind like layered filigree glass. That tweet looks like a dame.
Ah, none of you again. But yeah, a tweet came in and it was, I don't know if you guys saw it yesterday, but I think it was a couple of years ago now. Do you remember when, and Joe, you definitely do because we were working together when it happened and we both loved it.
Okay.
A man went on the news and he was using Skype and then his daughter walks in to the thing and she walks in a
big elbows.
Absolute ball away.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that went mad and everybody knew it. She was queen for a day. And then it went away. And obviously people have been waiting to see what the next one is. And two happened yesterday. Did you see this?
Yes.
Yeah. It was very exciting.
Happened.
Although I've only seen one of them. I just heard there was a second.
Mm. Which one did you see?
I saw the one where the Sky Man was very dismissive afterwards and there was some discussion about how rude he was.
Yeah, it looked rude.
I didn't like it.
I don't know if Gav's going to elaborate on the two different flavors of video that they were.
I can do.
Because the BBC one was heartwarming and lovely. It became a dialogue between the child and the news anchor.
Holy shit, that sounds amazing. Why haven't I...
Oh, it's really good.
It's very sweet. Whereas meanwhile on Sky, they cut her off like she just said cunt.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When actually it was just about biscuits. That sounds wicked.
It is really good. It's like, because the kid's not even asking for one biscuit. It's asking for two biscuits.
Mm-hmm.
Mum, can I have two biscuits? I love that. Yeah, the guy was about that. And mate, this is the thing. So this is what I kind of wanted to get on and talk about. Politics. I shook my pen then. You can't see that.
Yeah.
But that means I'm in business. That's when politics is about to happen.
Your frame rate's high enough that I actually get the effect of the wobbly pen.
Yeah.
Haven't I?
Very high quality.
But this is the thing. So I hadn't seen that Sky one, but the other one came into my timeline via someone tweeting. And it was a really nice one. I thought the BBC man was very sweet about it as well. Like the lady baby starts talking to the BBC man. And it's like, what's his name? Because she, you know, the little girl doesn't know she's fucking live on the news, does she?
Yeah.
And it's really nice and heartwarming. She's like, what's his name? I want an, and then she's asking him questions and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw someone had tweeted just saying, we need to normalize parents working from home. And it was like this wild way of approaching it where I was just like, why have you made this a thing?
Yeah. Yeah, because it was nice, and now it's an issue to be considered. It's like, no.
I thought it was going to be like someone being like, this baby's in the way of the news.
I mean, my hardcore politics hat on, I was saying the same thing, don't get me wrong. There's a time and a place for hijinks and biscuits. It is not when Gav wants his politics news.
Yeah.
What next? Emily Maitlis booted from Newsnight and we got a toddler shitting on the desk.
And that's the thing. I was like, why? How has it turned around? But then also, I think maybe it was obviously coming into people's spheres via the Sky Man who was like, get that fucking biscuit eating mongrel out of my head.
I've got to go to Westminster.
We'll go to the bloody king after this. We can't follow the king. We can't go to the king after we've been to a baby eating biscuits in this fucking country.
After we've been to a baby.
So maybe actually those people who were talking about it and saying, let's normalize. Like, obviously, I'm not saying that normalizing parents working from home is a bad thing. And that's obviously a good thing. But at the same time, it was like, I've only been brought into this story via people having a go about something. And I was like, that's why I very rarely spend lots of time on Twitter anymore. Because it's just like, and then, this also sounds like, you know, the people who are like, keep your politics out of my video games. Yes, it is kind of like that. Like, keep your politics out of my biscuit videos.
That's my fucking memes.
That's what I'm saying.
I think it's just people just can't just enjoy the biscuit baby. It's like, I like how the biscuit baby like properly like bangs on his mum's shoulder because she's ignoring him.
Yeah, like if he does it hard enough, biscuits might fly out of her nose or something. Yeah. Like a Pez dispenser.
I said, then when you're a baby, you don't understand, do you? All you know is the other day I hit my mum and biscuits fell into my mouth, yeah, 30 seconds later. So who knows how that whole system works? Yeah. I don't know.
The body is crazy. Like, yeah, anything could happen up there.
So I know, I know you're talking to Riz Latif, mum, but if you give me the biscuits, I'll leave and you can get on with your conversation about the Gaza Strip or whatever.
This would be easier for you if you just gave me two biscuits.
That's the thing. What they should bloody well normalise is you fucking feeding me properly. How about we normalise that so I'm not starving, fucking harassing you for crumbs?
That,
well, at a time when I know you can't hit me.
That would be the ultimate. That would be the ultimate, like, turnaround is if the baby became the news. Like, if the baby's reaction of, like, he just turns around, looks deep in the camera, just said, I haven't eaten for days. I just want two biscuits.
Hell.
In fact, now I want three biscuits. How about that? I want three biscuits or I'm staying here. Top's coming off.
That's when you know the kid's got a, you know, a rich future ahead of it. It starts bargaining for
in
biscuits.
Negotiations.
Well, I was speaking to my mum recently, and what I've always thought is a very funny story, or multiple funny stories about myself, is until I was like 6 years old, I would just point blank refuse to wear clothes for long periods of time. Mm-hmm. Like, I would just strip off, like, down to nothing. And it didn't matter if we were in our house, at a friend's house, in a supermarket. Like, my mum, if she took her eyes, this is how she phrased it. She's like, if I took my eyes off you for 2 seconds, I would turn around and you'd be naked. She was like, but not only that, if we were in a supermarket, you would throw your clothes away because you were obviously smart enough to know that if I can't find them, I can't make you wear them. And, like, I've always thought that this was, like, really, really funny. But, like, also, like, I was very poor growing up. So my mum would be like, we didn't have a lot of money for clothes, and you would just fucking boot trainers like into the eye like Quicksave, and we'd never see them again. So it was like,
so you'll be in Quicksave, like, you'll be naked, and your mum will be running up and down the aisle saying, I'm looking for my child's clothes.
Yeah.
I need clothes for my child. It's like, he had them when he came in, I swear.
Yeah. So it's like she's doing a grift. But yeah, like, and what I've always thought is a really funny story, actually, she was just like, it was a waking nightmare. And I just felt really bad for her.
You've just brought politics into your own fucking childhood anecdote.
Yeah, wow. That was a good anecdote until you had some sort of woke take on it.
Well, that's the thing, guys. That's what I've learned this week when I've been looking into politics, and I've been looking into politics features. What I've learned is, once you open that tap, it's running all the time. Now, politics is going to be in every single thing that I do, mm-hmm, in every biscuit that I eat, in every trainer that I boot down the aisle in Quicksave. Yeah, that's a political statement now.
Gav, yeah, you're taking off your trousers now.
I don't have any on.
Yeah, actually, you don't. Do you like that?
Nice.
Yeah. So there we go, boys. It's not a perfect politics feature, but it'll do.
But it is one.
Hey, yeah. Politics isn't perfect, so neither should features about it be.
Hey, I like it. I like it a lot.
Proof, if proof be need be. Politics are everywhere.
Regular features, come on.
Gentlemen, I had a feature all nice and ready to go this morning. Well, I say that. I had something I wanted to write about.
Yes.
It was about how conspiracy theories were fun again.
Are they?
Well, I thought they might be, and then I found out the conspiracy theory I was looking into was obviously racist. So,
no.
Conspiracy theories, news flash with politics, still not fun and won't be.
Shit.
So I did what I often do, and just searched for the phrase Africanized honeybees. Because I think a lot about the phrase Wu-Tang killer bees, we on a swarm from 1993's Clan in the Front.
Who doesn't?
It's a really good phrase and it trips off the tongue.
Do you remember, sorry, to cut across, slightly, I only remembered it because I saw it recently, but do you remember when we did an IGN UK podcast about Kung Fu Kenny?
Yes, I do.
And like the title for that is about Kung Fu Kenny. And we don't really talk, we just talk about who is Kung Fu Kenny? What is he about? And that is the entire crux of that feature on the IGN UK podcast.
Kung Fu Kenny, of course, yeah. Based slightly on Don Cheadle's character in Rush Hour 2, a personal favourite film. But what I found when I searched for Africanized honeybees was a genuinely very interesting article called What Turns Bees into Killer Bees, which might as well be called Why You Have to Be Mad. And basically, scientists, this is a good science bit because I find it interesting. I just thought I'd spread this knowledge. Scientists will anger bees, freeze them, slice their brains open, and then use protein detection methods to discover that they have two different proteins in their brains that can break apart and become neuropeptides that cause aggressive behavior. And what they did... Oh, Steve, you look interested.
I'm fascinated by the fact that if you freeze an angry bee, it stays angry and frozen. It's frozen in the emotion that it was stuck in. Well,
good about this is that what they'd do is they'd anger the Africanized honeybees in the hive. And the ones that came out, they freeze them. They're like, they're the angry bees, so they're going to have the angry proteins.
Mm-hmm.
And then the nice bees that stayed inside, they freeze them and cut them open and realize they've got less of the angry proteins.
Right.
So they've worked out what makes them angry on a base level, right? Right. But then they got those proteins and they injected them into nice bees and they became angry bees. So it's all about this protein, right? And they've done this to flies and they did it to some mice, which terrifies me because mice are getting to the level of actually bothering me.
What comes next? You're going to be injecting pigs, then you're going to have furious swine roaming towns and villages across the land, biting people's legs.
Giant angry protein pigs. So basically, to cut a long story short, bad bees have got some sort of juice in their brain that explodes when there's a threat and it makes them go mental and kill you. That's the science. And it's very impressive and interesting, and it goes some way to explaining aggression in animals across phyla. But what I really liked, the detail I thought was fantastic about this scientific theory, and this is true, is how they made the bees angry. So... biochemist Mario Palmer from the something Institute of Rio de Janeiro needed to find a way.
Why did you say it like that?
Because I couldn't remember it. I was making fun of myself.
That's not like you were making fun of him, but his job.
That's not how Brazilians speak. So they needed a way to simultaneously anger the bees and collect them without getting stung to fuck. Right? And so they must have considered loads of stuff, but genuinely, after all their deliberation, the scientific method for getting bees that are furious with you was to go in front of the hive with a big black ball made of leather and just swing it about as fast as possible.
I can see that.
They just get this leather ball and just like fucking rag it around.
Smacking the hive or just near the hive?
No, just near the hive. Just doing like fucking... Diablo work on a high street. Like, it might as well be doing a Diablo made of leather. And then the angry bees would come out and then they'd fly and sting the ball and get stuck in the ball. And
that's because they must think it's a giant round bee.
Yeah, huge round bee.
That won't quit it.
Look at that cow bee. Kill it.
Or like a big show off.
I just thought that was really funny.
I love it.
Because it's a mad way to get some bees. So I thought I'd come up with three more scientific methods of making bees furious for science. Mm. These are them. Method one, bee wife. And I've separated these into the correct sections for academic study, abstract, method, and hypothesis. So abstract, make lots of bees furious at one other bee, but make that bee more furious than all the other bees combined. So in the method is, in the dead of night, we'll use that sleeping gas that beekeepers use to steal all the long honey blocks that bees make and look in one of their hexagonal sleeping chambers that bees use. We'll find a bee couple and covertly steal the wife bee using some tweezers and leave behind some fake bee blood. And then we'll deliver a tiny envelope to the big blue hexagon that indicates the bee police, implicating the bee husband in the wife bee's murder. And this will kick off a chain reaction. The husband bee will feel simultaneously upset, outraged, and misunderstood upon being accused of murder, and it will cause him to flee the hive. And we will term this bee the Harrison Ford bee. The bee police will feel understandably upset at a murder in their jurisdiction and will give chase. And one chief bee will probably become more single-mindedly furious than the rest, and we will term this bee Tommy Bee Jones. And eventually, the two key bees will fly into a storm drain and the Harrison Ford bee will say, "I didn't kill my wife!" And Tommy Bee Jones will say, "I don't care!" And then we'll catch both of them in a shoe. Hypothesis, furious bees. Method two.
I like that you made a pun for Tommy Bee Jones.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but you just skipped over Harrison Ford.
Well, there isn't one. Well, it's just the Harrison Ford bee.
Well, I thought that you were going to do something because you made a really big point of saying Fleed. And I was like, I thought you were going to call him, we'll call this one Harrison Fleed.
That would be insane. It's a different angry animal. Anyway, that's my first method for use if science wants it. Method two, bad hive. Mm-hmm. Abstract, exploit bad bees' intolerance for shit hives. Method, acting normally, researchers will set down a new hive next to the original angry bees' hive. Except this is no ordinary hive, it's a Trojan hive, and hidden inside is a scientist with a saxophone. On day one, the scientist will simply hum songs to himself from inside the hive. The real bees will be confused by this, especially as no bees will be emerging from the various hive holes of their new neighbor hive. But they will put this down to unusual foreign bee behavior. On day two, the scientist will play the saxophone, but using a mute. The real bees will begin to worry about their new neighbor's habits, but their intact brain proteins will mean they'll chalk it up to a hive warming party or something and try to chill out. On day three, the scientist will play the saxophone at full blast, and the bees will go absolutely berserk and will fly out to invade the Trojan hive, straight into a bunch of oven gloves that we've sellotaped to the outside of the hive holes, where they'll get stuck in the shape of big swarming hands. Hypothesis, shit angry bees. Method three, telegram makeover deception for bees. Abstract, we will scoop up at dead angry bees. Method, early in the morning, while all the bees do their calisthenics, I shouldn't find this as funny as I do, a researcher will leave an anonymous letter next to the hive. With typical bee hard work and aptitude, the bees will find, manipulate, and open the letter, and the queen will read it out loud. Bees, stop. Bear spotted in meadow, stop. The bear is wearing gloves, stop. The gloves are probably an innovation for preventing stings while dipping hands in honey, stop. It is in your interests to intervene, stop. Following that announcement, all the bees will immediately leave the hive to tackle the threat. And that's when the fun begins. We'll bring in a crack team of home makeover experts and pimp out this hive big style, adding a honey fountain, suicide doors, and working human toilets. And we'll top it all off with a classy matte black finish. When the bees return, we'll witness some bees absolutely loving it and walking around every room and going, "Oh my God!" But some bees will question whether this was ever their hive to begin with. A bee civil war will begin, and there will be loads of neuropeptides shooting about. When the battle is over, the queen is dead, and the last survivors limp into the wide world, scientists will pop out of all the human-sized toilets and scoop up the bodies. Hypothesis, dead angry bees. And the results I've written, wild, baby.
Can't argue with
nope.
that.
Sounds conclusive.
Yeah. Those are my methods for bee capture. I kind of forgot halfway through whether I was capturing the bees or if it was for the proteins. You know, science will work it out.
It's fine. I think that's what's called a meta study.
Yeah.
I know you said that you were trying to do a story about conspiracies, but is the real story that this morning you thought of Tommy B. Jones? And then you were like,
mate,
right.
Tommy B. Jones. That was a flash of inspiration mid-fugitive reference. All I wanted was a bee to shout, I didn't kill my wife, and everything else flowed like honeyed water.
Excellent.
And Honeyson Ford. That's the best I could do.
That's actually, yeah.
It's not great.
I still like
Harrison Fleed.
Harrison Fleed.
It's better than that.
But bees aren't fleas.
I know, but he said flea, so I thought it was going to be a fit. No, I'm saying honey bee Ford or whatever you said. That's good.
Honey bee Ford is good. I still like Harrison Ford bee, so that's what we're going with.
That's what we're going with. Yeah, I was going to get you to record that feature again with my notes.
In when we go back in 20 years and remaster all of regular features for the laser discs, which I'm told it's cyclical. It will be back.
The next step.
I'm not saying I know what a laser disc is, a circle. I'm not saying that. I'm saying outside of that. But when we go back to do that, then I'm really excited.
Yeah.
To put Honey Bee Ford.
Yeah. Big CGBs everywhere.
Big CGBGs.
CGBGs. Hosted by the Bee Gees. With a foreword from the Fugees. Features. Well, that's it for this week's episode of the Regular Features Podcast. Thank you for listening. Thank you for being our friends. And if you like what you heard, you can go to patreon.com/ Regular Features and subscribe. Become a paid up member of the Reader Raft for just the low price of whatever you think this bad boy is worth. I would like to shout out some people who have recently joined the Patreon.
Me too.
Can I do that?
Ooh, yes, please.
I'd like you to give these people their rightful birthright bee names.
Oh, okay.
Say hello to Ryan Brogan.
Hyven Brogan.
They're all going to be
Hyven. Stripey Brogan.
How about this one's going to stump you. Paw.
What?
Paw. Like a dog's paw.
That's not. Is it?
Paw. Like a buzz. Paw.
Like it's just a sound. Okay, we'll take that. And Ryan Lloyd.
What was the one we did for the last Ryan?
Fucking hell.
Hive.
Hyven.
Hyven Lloyd.
Can't do that again.
Stripey Lloyd.
Right. Yeah, so that was a bad way of doing the Patreon outro. But hey.
I liked it.
This is a one-take thing. We're not going to go back and do that again. Whoa. What's that beep? Just me?
Beep.
You. It's on you,
just
mate.
On me.
Are you all right?
Well, it's really hot in this room, actually. Yeah.
You just hear...
Well, I've had a great time on the podcast. I don't know about you guys.
Yeah.
Me too. Lovely. Love it.
Should we do it again next week?
Go on.
Why not?
I would like to do that too. Thank you for listening. We'll be back next week. Goodbye.
Regular Ficheros.
We did a little bit of chat that might end up in there anyway, so that's perfect. What a great idea.
Or Logs Pub Chat.
Yeah.
Oh, that's got to go in. Yeah.
I was going to do some more chat. No. I'm buzzing about your feature, Joe. I'll just put that in somewhere because that's good. That's
at the end of Gav's feature way earlier.
As if you've just known. Put it like
second sentence of my feature.
That would look so rude. I'd love it.
I'm into it.
Right, we stopping?
Yeah.
Lovely.
Shut it down.